Claudio.
Or is it here?
I use mine.
You use yours.
Okay. Yes, or should we give it a try?
Space?
No. Okay. And this time it works. This was another presentation than before.
Okay.
Well done.
I have paper too.
But you need the microphone.
Yeah, give me a second. Okay, so hello everybody. Thanks for having me here. As mentioned, I'm gonna speak a little bit about what's happening in Hong Kong. I don't know how many of you are following what's been happening in the last week, but if you have been following, then you know that there's been some shit going on there. And before going into the details of what's actually happening, I think it's important to step back a little bit. I have a lot of slides. It's mostly just pictures. I will run through them quickly. If I don't manage to cover everything, just get me later, and I will answer your question and so on. So, Hong Kong. This is Hong Kong. What's been happening and why it's been happening, I think it's kind of a result of a lot of things that have been evolving over the last 150 years. So you're not familiar with Hong Kong. It's basically a weird city that it's not actually a state, and it's not fully independent, but it somewhat is. Hong Kong was basically just sort of an island, and it was originally occupied by the British Empire in somewhere around end of, I actually have dates, so that's why I have paper. Exactly in 1842, the British made it a colony. It basically took over control of the island after the First Opium War. So China kind of gave it away, or rather, they left it being occupied by them. And then it stayed British colony until 1941. Then during World War II, it was briefly occupied by Japanese people. And then it got back under the control of the British people in 1945. What happened there is basically that as a result of this Opium War, which is not very important, but basically was the result of some mishandling of the relationship between China and the British Empire on the import-export of opium. Then it kind of went to shit, and they started having a war. China lost, and then as a result, China literally gave it on a lease for 99 years to the British Empire. So Hong Kong became basically a colony, and it's been a colony for a long time. This lease expired in 1997, and that's when China took back control over Hong Kong. Although it wasn't fully brought back into the state, it was kind of left as an autonomous city, basically, in itself. Just consider that back then it was basically just 5,000 people, so Hong Kong was literally nothing, and it grew to almost 7 million people over the last 100 years, mostly because of economic incentives that the British Empire brought to it. So you can kind of realize that all of these moving around of the Hong Kong people led to the situation that it is now, which is basically a situation where they have their own culture, they have their own kind of dialect or language, I think. They have their own economy, which is very strong. The Hong Kong stock market is the third biggest in the world, so it's a very strong capitalist city in itself. And the control that China still tried to exercise over Hong Kong is very strong, because obviously they have economic interests over them too. So the protests that happened in the last weeks were kind of inevitable, I think. So what happened? Basically, in the last months or so, there has been a lot of discussion for the upcoming elections in Hong Kong that are going down in 2017. The people of Hong Kong wanted to have normal elections. As it is now, they don't have a governor, they have a chief executive, which is kind of weird. And this chief executive is basically selected by a committee, which has is a lot influenced by the Chinese government, of course. So the people of Hong Kong have tried to ask for elections, and we're almost getting to the point of having something closer to that. But China interfered and said, okay, you can have your elections, but we're going to choose who are going to be the candidates. So people got pissed, obviously. And as a result, some students and some other groups of people in Hong Kong started organizing to run some protests around this issue. So it was not like an immediate thing. It's something that has been building up over the last year. So what I've been basically asking is for universal suffrage and for some electoral reform that would leave out all of these interference with China within the local elections. And they also want the current chief executive, which is this guy who is CEY Leung, I think, to resign. As a result, basically, a lot of people went to the streets to protest against the decision of China to have a saying on how the election should be run. Massive protests started running. This photo is from Admiralty, which is basically an area in Hong Kong where there's a lot of financial buildings and government buildings and so on. There's also Chinese armor barracks in there, which is kind of weird. The authorities were not really prepared, I think, to handle the situation because hundreds of thousands of people actually went to the streets. Was mostly students organized by student groups of the different universities of Hong Kong. During the first days of the protest, they kind of abused a little bit of force. You can see they started using pepper spray, even with a certain amount of accuracy. And then they also went to use tear gas. And at that point, things kind of started getting a little bit bad. If it wasn't clear enough, they were also prompting some warnings. As a result of these amount of force that it started exercising over the people, the obvious result, as it always happens, is that more people went to the protests. This time they brought umbrellas, though. So basically they thought, okay, they're using tear gas, they're using pepper spray, we'll bring umbrellas to protect ourselves. And this is basically what brought to the umbrella men. So the people are now calling in the umbrella revolution, and all of it comes from there. However, this was the first days. Then a lot of pressure was put over the authorities in Hong Kong. They asked to stop using this amount of force from the police. So things kind of started settling a little bit. The protests expanded over the city, so in different areas of the city there were different protests. And in some areas, some violence started getting back again, but not this time from the police, but from other groups. More specifically, this was an article from The Guardian. In one specific area of Hong Kong, which is Mong Kok, a lot of violence happened in there. Who was these people that started protesting against them is not clear. Some of them say that it's just anti-Occupy people, some of them just citizens. There is some speculation that it might be people also from the triads, so from the local organized crime. So also you can see central government and triad offices there. And when that happens, so a lot of clashes happen between these different groups. The students and the protesters started stepping back a little bit from Mong Kok, and that caused a little bit of issues within themselves. So they kind of split apart. It wasn't clear if they were going to stay, if they were going to move. So during the last weekend, basically things started like dying down a little bit. However, some protesters still kept some of the barricades. There's still the main tent village and so on are still there. But one of the most interesting things of this protest is obviously what everyone has been talking about, which is the use of technology, phones, online media, and so on. This is a picture from the students that have been protesting and showing off all their smartphones. So there has been a bunch of interesting things happening on a digital sphere during the protests. That a lot of the media actually misrepresented or didn't cover at all. Probably the most covert thing was the use of fire chat during the protests. What basically happened was that one of the key or basically coordinators of the protests says, you should guys all download fire chat and start using it for communicating in case the internet goes down. There was some speculation, some rumors that in fact internet was going to be took down during the protests. It actually never happened, but there were a little bit of throttling. There was a lot of activity in the GSM network, so the network was not very stable in itself, but not because of conspiracies. So this app got a lot of attention. A lot of media sort of saying this protest is powered by FireChat. People are talking about FireChat. It's great. Even got to the length of saying that it crashes the Great Firewall, which is kind of funny because actually the Great Firewall of China doesn't affect Hong Kong at all. But it wasn't clear if it was really used. I got some reports from a bunch of people saying that in fact wasn't really used a whole lot, mostly because still the internet was up, there wasn't really an interest in using FireChat specifically. The main characteristic of FireChat was that it's able to basically not just communicate over the internet, but it can establish basically a local network through Bluetooth. So you can send messaging through Bluetooth to the different devices that have it enabled in the local area. And that's why they kind of thought, okay, we could use it in case the network goes down. Some people said, you know, there's actually not many people using it. It's still not clear to me whether that's actually true, but what it's clear is that it was misused a lot to spread false information and, you know, just rumors, and it wasn't particularly helpful for the people on the ground. Even to the point where there were even people apparently spreading messaging, offering money to stop protesting or protesting against the actual protesters. So this whole FireChat issue, I think, in my mind, was a little bit overblown, but basically, you know, it was not actually that important. What about China? In all of this, China was a little bit left out, so it wasn't really covered that much what was China's interest in all of this. They were particularly silent during the protests. They didn't have any particular strategy to address it besides just let it down by itself. However, in the background, there was a lot of things happening on the internet against Hong Kong people within China mainland itself, especially a lot of censorship. When the protests started happening, it was obvious that a lot of censorship started happening around the topics of the protests. So if you go online and search for reports about this, you'll find a lot of people tweeting about messaging suddenly disappearing from the different services. So this is Baidu, which is kind of the Chinese counterpart of Google, I suspect. And all messages that had to do somewhat with the protests were basically removed and censored and blocked during the course of the days. And this was just a few days ago, October 4. Same thing, images were just removed. This is, again, comparison between Google images and Baidu images. So you can see that on one side it shows protests, on the other side it just shows umbrellas. So they were very careful of blocking as much content as possible related to the protests during the course of the days. They didn't want people to speak out a whole lot, especially in mainland China. The reason is because there's two reasons, I guess. The first one being that Hong Kong is particularly important in this specific moment because it was not just an isolated case. There were protests during the course of the last year in Taiwan, for example, too. In April, there were students that were protesting against mostly was trade agreements between Taiwan and China, but still there was a lot of activity there too. Protesters occupied buildings of the government in Taiwan, and they obviously don't want to have this kind of social movement of people from these autonomous cities of satellite China basically brought back to the mainland China. And the second issue obviously is that they do have a lot of interest in Hong Kong. They want it to stay as it is. They don't want it to change. They don't want it to get more democratic. They don't want to lose control over Hong Kong either, but they don't want to change it radically. Hong Kong could never function in the way that the normal Chinese system would, because as I said, it's a very capitalistic city and it needs to remain operating as it is right now. Other censorship, really funny ones. This is someone tweeting about her account on WeChat having had her image removed. And similar things were happening all over on Weibo, on WeChat, and so on. This is an interesting graph that shows basically the amount of messages from Weibo, I think. Yeah. So Weibo is basically the Chinese Twitter counterpart. In China, they have counterparts for basically all services. And you can see that during the protests, the spike of messages that got removed kind of increased a whole lot. So they started censoring heavily during those days. Besides that, apparently China also started operating a lot of man-in-the-middle attacks in a very obvious way as well. So Yahoo and Google, GitHub I think was on a different time, but basically Google and Yahoo were both under man-in-the-middle attacks during the course of the protests. They used self-signed certificates, so it was stupidly obvious they were doing it, but still it's kind of a chilling effect over what people are doing over the internet. At the same time, I'm actually not completely sure, for example, Chrome and Firefox are not really popular in China. The most popular one is Internet Explorer, and the next ones are some Chinese browsers that are not really well known outside of China. And these Chinese Chinese browsers don't show, for example, these kind of alerts. So if you're using a normal browser, Chinese browser in China, you wouldn't actually notice of the man-in-the-middle attack. More sophisticated things actually happened during the course of the protests. So one thing that we observed was that some spyware, some Android spyware, was sent through to basically, allegedly, it's not actually clear, but to all people using WhatsApp in Hong Kong. It pretended to be an application to coordinate the protests of Occupy Central from Code4HK, which is basically a group of techno activists, let's say, in Hong Kong that had nothing to do whatsoever with this application. And this application instead was actually a spyware. It was doing, you know, tracking the geographical location of the victims, stealing emails, you know, the usual business. Other interesting things that happened. We noticed, for example, that the website of the Democratic Party of Hong Kong was compromised, and we realized it has been compromised for almost a month, probably more than that. So what happened was basically they injected some JavaScript code into one of the JavaScript files originally of the website, and when you would visit it, you would get basically that JavaScript executed, and then it would trigger some exploits and dropping some malware. So we actually weren't able to grab the spyware that was being deployed, neither the exploit. We have some copies, but I'm actually not sure if it's the same specific ones. That domain that you can see, java-c.com, was already known before it was being already used in other surveillance operations in the past. And this actually still is compromised, still serves this JavaScript file. Although the JavaScript had been taken down, the website is still compromised. An interesting thing is that, as I said, it hasn't been an immediate thing. Oh yes, another thing. Well, besides this attack, there's been also a whole bunch of DDoS attacks over the last days. Some of them are still ongoing, actually, especially against media and some activist groups and democracy groups in Hong Kong. So they managed to knock offline most of the websites that are related to the protests during the course of that. Obviously, the reason is to, you know, trying to silence and block as much information spreading as possible during the protests. However, as I was saying, it wasn't something immediate. It's something that grew over the last year or so. As a matter of fact, some DDoS attacks happened even before. This is from an article in June, and some DDoS attacks were already happening back then during the democracy polls that were happening in Hong Kong. We found that another website from another democracy organization in Hong Kong was compromised exactly in the same way, with exact same kind of script already in June or July. So you can see that they kind of were prepared of this to happen and started, you know, acting accordingly. Besides this kind of things, some other small considerations. One interesting leverage that China government had was the fact that allegedly some of the protests were kind of manipulated by foreign media and foreign organizations. It is true, in fact, that there was some financing of some organization tied to the USAID, specifically the National Endowment for Democracy, that funded some forums, discussion forums in Hong Kong that were basically dealing with democracy protests and so on. But personally, I don't think it's actually that relevant. And especially, there's a lot of confusion because the people protesting in Hong Kong is not just Occupy Central. Occupy Central is one part of it. The student protest is actually kind of separated and they got merged in together. So I don't think it actually it's you know, undermining the cause of the protest in itself. However, things kind of started dying down over the course of the weekend. The protesters kind of started going back home. They tried to set an ultimatum to the chief executive to resign. It didn't work out. At the same time, also the authorities gave them an ultimatum to free some areas of Hong Kong, and they actually managed to do it. So some of the more, you know, hardcore protest areas were actually abandoned. There's still some protests going on, but in a much smaller scale. See, this was actually some pictures from this morning or yesterday morning. So you can see that the amount of people is reasonably lower. It seems that they're still gathering there in the evenings. However, like the actual more active protest activity seems to have come to an end. And it will probably remain so unless the negotiations that are expected to happen in the next days with the authorities actually fail. But for the moment, it's kind of reached a stable situation. Cyber attacks are still ongoing. We have found traces of more targeted attacks against specific groups in Hong Kong, also dating back to 6 months, 12 months ago. I'm still investigating into this matter specifically, so I don't have all much of details yet. Yeah, that's basically it. The current status is basically this. People are still sitting there waiting for something to happen. It's not clear what the outcome will be. I think it will be really, really interesting to see what will be the result of the negotiations, if there will be any. However, yeah, this is actually a picture from today, a few hours ago. So yeah, that's basically it. So that's basically what's been happening in Hong Kong and in a very short time. If you have any questions, as I said, there's like many aspects to this, especially on the technical side. I can't obviously go into details because I'm way over time already. But if you're interested in more details on the specific attacks, or if you actually know something that I might be interested in, please reach out to me. And if you have any questions, just catch me outside. I'll be there. Thanks.